June the 3rd, 1989, the New York Times described this performance as being among the most memorable jazz events of the decade. The world premiere of the longest and largest work ever composed for jazz orchestra, Epitaph by Charles Mingus. Mingus was a justly celebrated bass player, and as an innovative jazz composer, he's ranked among the greats alongside Duke Ellington. Among the musicians assembled for this performance are many world-famous jazz artists. Snooky Young is a veteran of the bands of Lionel Hampton and Count Basie. Next to him, Lou Soloff. He and Randy Brecker were both trumpeters in the Blood, Sweat and Tears group. Jack Walworth played regularly with Mingus in the 1970s. Joe Wilder is another Hampton and Basie veteran, while Wynton Marsalis is one of the new generation of international jazz stars. Among the trombonists is Britt Woodman, for many years lead trombone with Duke Ellington. Herbie Green played trombone in the bands of Woody Herman and Benny Goodman. On the front bench of the saxophones is the alto sax player Bobby Watson, at one time music director of Art Blakey's Jazz Messengers. Next to him, John Handy, a frequent performer with Charles Mingus. Jerome Richardson played saxophone with Lionel Hampton and Earl Hines. And at the end of the row, there's George Adams, of all the musicians here tonight, the one who played most often with Charlie Mingus himself. The concert is introduced by the composer's widow.
My name is Sue Mingus, and I'd like to thank all of you for coming. It's thrilling to have found out that we actually sold out this concert, and I thank all of you. This music has been waiting for 30 years, and in some case 50 years, one of the sections Mingus wrote when he was 17, to be heard. People used to call Mingus crazy and paranoid a lot for fighting the difficulties he had in getting his music performed and fighting the ills of society. And he heard that word paranoid so much. When he was dying, I actually overheard him use it sitting in his wheelchair, talking to a friend on the telephone, and he said he didn't think he was really sick. He said he thought he was suffering from a severe case of paranoid delusion. This irony surfaced in the title Epitaph, in the comment that he made that he wrote it for his tombstone. He knew he probably was not going to have an opportunity to have it performed when he was alive. And I would like to thank all those people who have made this event possible. First of all, Andrew Homsey and his wife, Francine Dupuy, who discovered this piece sorting through sheets of paper in my apartment when they were cataloging all of Mingus's works. They pieced it together by measure number, like detectives. And after that, the Ford Foundation, who made it possible to copy this incredible amount of music. There were 500 pages, over 4,000 measures. It took 4 months, 5 months actually, 20 copyists, two different computer programs, and almost cost the life of Paul Sadowski, who hasn't been to sleep for 4 days and hasn't had a day off since January 1st. I don't know if he's here, but if you are, God bless you, Paul Sadowski. And also the National Endowment for the Arts, who has supported Mingus programs for the last 5 years. And finally, Gunther Schuller. There are almost no words in my vocabulary to describe Gunther. It was his energy and conviction and generosity in this project that animated it from the very beginning. And without him, it certainly would never have happened. And because I think Mingus probably would have said something in the middle of all this joy and pleasure about the other side, I would like everybody to think a little bit about what it must have been like to have been a composer like Mingus and have had all this music in his head and not have had an opportunity to get it out the way he wanted to get it out. And hopefully there are people working for this to encourage music of value and not just what makes money. And in this context, I'm proud and pleased to introduce someone whose job it is to do just this, New York City's Commissioner of Cultural Affairs, Mary Campbell.
It's hard to believe, but the work of many of our greatest jazz musicians remains uncollected, undocumented, unpreserved. We really have Sue Mingus to thank for her efforts to salvage Charles Mingus's epitaph, and I want to thank her tonight for that. Mingus once wrote, "My music is evidence of my soul's will to live." And I can't help but think that Charlie Mingus's restless and stormy soul had something to do with those fragments coming together, something to do with Gunter Schuller taking on this Herculean task, something to do with these 30 remarkable musicians who came together. The city of New York is privileged to be the premier site for this performance. Thank you, Sue.
Thank you. Thank you.